Hello anatomy colleagues, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this learning objective video, we will be discussing the pelvic girdle, one of my all-time favorite topics. So our focus will be talking about the major features or structures of the pelvic girdle, and begin introducing you to terms that you'll need to be familiar with as you go further with some of the upcoming clinical lectures. So the pelvic girdle is the means by which the lower back is going to connect with the lower limbs. And this area is important in terms of locomotion, but as well as maintaining upright posture. So the pelvic girdle is officially formed by the paired coxal bones, which goes by many, many different names. You'll hear coxal bones. Another very common term is just simply the hip bones. And there are some other terms you may hear as well. And these bones will articulate with the sacrum, or that one of the distal portions of the spinal column. So that's going to be this posterior portion of the pelvic girdle. There are three major joints or articulations of the true pelvic girdle. You are going to have the paired sacroiliac joints, which I'm circling right here. You'll often hear these abbreviated as the SI joints. These are where the coxal bones articulate with the sacrum. And these are weight-bearing compound joints that only allow a very slight mobility, which makes sense regarding its important role in terms of bearing the weight of that upright posture. The other major joint is going to be the pubic symphysis, and this is an unpaired joint. It is where the pubic portions of the two coxal bones meet anteriorly in a cartilaginous joint, and there's very little mobility in this particular joint as well. And although the femurs are not officially a part of the pelvic girdle, they are very closely associated as the lower limb component that articulate with the coxal bones to form the hip joints. So the hip joints are going to be where that coxal bone articulates with the head of the femur. So let's talk about the coxal bone. Although in adults, this bone is fully fused, anatomists and clinicians still often speak of this bone and its features with reference to the separate bones that are present during infancy and childhood. These parts include the ilium, which is going to be the largest portion. It's rather distinctly fan-shaped. You'll hear it often described as that, and it's going to be more superiorly placed. Next, you'll have the ischium, which is very robust. You can see the large ischial tuberosity right here, often referred to as the sit bones. And it's going to be more posteriorly placed. And the smallest portion is going to be the pubis, or often you hear this referred to as the pubic bone. And this is going to be the most anteriorly placed portion of the coxal bone. And these three bones will typically be completely fused by early adulthood and after puberty. And during childhood, there will be cartilage in this particular region, like right in here. You can sometimes see where it's kind of left over or where it had been before it was completely replaced with bone in a fully formed adult bone. This area where that cartilage sat, where these bones are all going to articulate, is called the acetabulum. And we'll talk quite a bit about this, or quite more about this, during the musculoskeletal portion of your curriculum. And this is where that femoral head will articulate with the coxal bone to form the hip joint. Okay, the bony rim that is going to be identified here with this dashed line, that's going to surround and define the pelvic inlet is referred to as the pelvic brim. Occasionally, you will hear the terms pelvic brim and pelvic inlet used interchangeably, and that isn't exactly correct, even though they're very closely associated. The pelvic inlet is the superior pelvic aperture, so it's the space, whereas the brim is the bony rim, so the bone that's actually defining that opening. The brim is going to start around the sacral promontory. It will continue along the ilium, and then it will go along the superior portion of the pubis. And so it's really important in terms of getting an idea of where the pelvic inlet is going to be located, but it also can help you differentiate and understand the demarcation between the false and the true pelvis. So let's start with the false pelvis, often referred to as the greater pelvis as well because of its larger size. The false pelvis is going to be superior to the pelvic inlet and is typically occupied by abdominal viscera. So things such as the ilium and the sigmoid colon, it's in this kind of peach color identified here. The true or lesser pelvis is located between the pelvic inlet and the pelvic outlet, which is a little hard to conceptualize in this image, but it's going to extend between the tip of the coccyx, kind of towards the ischial tuberosities, which are not easily viewable here because they're so posteriorly placed, and the pubic arch anteriorly. So it'd be kind of, you know, give or take right around here, but kind of on the inside. All right, so that true pelvis is going to be between the pelvic inlet and the pelvic outlet. And that pelvic outlet is the inferior pelvic aperture. The true pelvis is going to include the true pelvic cavity as well as deep parts of the perineum. So this area is major importance in terms of gynecological significance, and we'll spend quite a bit of time discussing the viscera located in this area as well in future learning objective videos. All right, so those are the major structures associated with the pelvic girdle, and this is the super awesome summary slide. Please take time to review these high yield concepts and reach out with any questions you may have. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.